Okay, this is an enormous topic that I am broaching today, and would not just be the subject of a 14-week course, but a lifetime of reading in this particular aspect of poetry. We offer spiritual writing. I've done three workshops here, but I think this is the first one where I or someone else here addresses this topic. Though it might have seemed sort of an obvious choice to pick a certain, shall I say, church focus given our setting here. I've been reading all these people for a long time, and I will tell you straight up that I was born Jewish and am a practicing Buddhist. That makes me a Jew-boo, as they say these days in the United States. As I say, these people have spoken to me. Today, I could deliver a long preamble, but I think why these people are crucial to me, above and beyond the specific spiritual background each of them has, is that each of them speaks very strongly to the value of that amorphous but very crucial term, inner life. At this point in time, on my bad days, I feel that that world, the inner world, is threatened on many, many fronts. But these people seem to me to be, avatars of the inner life. We're talking today about spirit. So we're not talking about organized religion per se. One thing I want us to consider today is the fact that these are poems that we're going to be looking at. These aren't, liturgical pieces. They're poems. So what I have up on the board here are some doors that I want us to approach these poems through to focus our discussion today, because this is very much a discussion, not a lecture. So they are style, approach, and function, by which I mean, what kind of a poem are we looking at here? These poems are not just, self-expression, not what they're doing. They are involved in engaging different paths, modes, ways into the spirit world. Vocabulary. Obviously a big one. Obviously there is an enormous vocabulary in every spiritual tradition. Transfiguration and memory, how the changes occur in the work, how the changes are noted in the world around the poet. Mystery and sacred, for me maybe the biggest one. I think poetry is, sort of the elaboration of mystery. So that's, a contradiction in terms, but a good contradiction, a contradiction that wants to be there. And sacredness. I've been reading a lot lately of Ted Hughes, as my workshop knows, and known to the world as Sylvia Plath's first husband and only husband. And Ted Hughes, his poetry and his writing is a long protest against what he calls the desacralization of the world. If anything's going to kill us, that's what's going to kill us, that we don't feel the world is sacred. So that's part of involved in the that margin of mystery. Another way of saying the mystery part is the human mind is not the measure of really anything. you know? So when we reduce everything to the human mind, we're in trouble. And spiritual writing pushes back at that. Okay, then the poet, the role of the poet in the poem. And then what I call poemhood. How is this a poem? You know, what makes this a poem? Okay. So let's dive in, because we have a lot of poems to look at, and as always, a limited amount of time. So I'm going to do this kind of round robin. I'm going to do one by each of the four different poets, and then we'll do another round by each of the four different poets, and I hope we have time to cover them. So let's start in with A Night in Ireland by Ann Porter. Ann Porter died a few years ago at the good old age of 99. She's really a marvelous poet. A Night in Ireland by Ann Porter. Our steamship docked at night in Cove, an Irish seaport, a small one in those days. Not an inn, not a tavern was open, and we had to wait till morning for the train to Fermoy. But in the wooded hills up above the town, nightingales were awake. All the dark thickets were rich with their songs. It was on that night and in those woods, I dreamed that I found the door of all doors, the most hidden and most renowned. Overgrown with nettles, rustic and low, built as if for children or as a gate for sheep in some backcountry pasture. And through a chink in the door, I saw the marvelous light that's purest of all lights. Neither sun nor moon nor any star I know of could give such light. And I saw crowds of the blessed, from the greatest to the smallest. The smallest were running and laughing. And Christ the Lord was with them, and also Mary. But before I could knock at the door, someone spoke to me. I think it was an angel. He said, "You've come too soon. Go back into the towns. Live there as love's apprentice, and God will give you his kingdom." I woke up just before sunrise, when the nightingales ended their songs. Dew gathered on the ferns, and the cool woods gave off a scent of earth in the early morning. I was hungry and cold, and I started back to the town at the first signs of day. Already a sunlit smoke was rising from the chimneys and mist from the water. I heard a rooster crowing, and then I heard the whistle of the train to Fermoy. Okay, what do we have here to you? What kind of poem do we have here? To me, what she's presenting, and I think that's why, in a sense, I wanted to begin with this one, because I think it's really crucial to the tradition that we're looking at today, is this is a vision. Okay, this is a vision. You tell me, what does that word mean to you if I say it's a vision? What do we have here? How could you speak to that word, that this is a kind of vision that's being presented to us? I think it's a vision in a couple of senses, really, but I want to hear if you have any thoughts about that in terms of what is what's going on here? You know, what is she doing here? Yeah, Bethany.
It makes me think of like religious revelations or something, like yeah. Mark getting directions to do something.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, that's a great word, revelation. Okay. And we know that word, but let's think about it. That's a great word. What's revealed here? Okay, that's what's in the word revelation, right? What is revealed? In a vision, something is revealed, right? In the Native American tradition, someone goes out on a vision quest, and then a spirit of an animal or whatever speaks to the person, and there is a kind of revelation. There's a vision. Something is manifested, right? So what's happening here? What's manifested? What's revealed here? Yes?
It's a new life's purpose.
Okay, yeah, yeah. Renewed life's purpose. Okay, that's a huge one. Okay, that's a huge one, right? The beginning of the, you know, divine comedy, the commedia, right? Lost in a dark wood, you know, which is where we all are. Okay? Okay, tell me more about it in terms of how it presents a kind of vision. What kind of vision do we get? Well, we get the vision, right, of what? We get the vision of whatever you want to call it, the other world. Okay, right? She thinks it was an angel that spoke to her, okay? So that's a crucial vision that spiritual writing for thousands of years has offered to human beings, this vision of the spirit world, okay? What other vision is offered in here, though? It seems to me there's another vision. What happens after she talks, you know, hears what the angel has to tell her? What happens after that in the latter part of the poem? Where does it go? What happens? Does she just say, oh, and that was that? You know, no, she doesn't. Okay, where does she go? Yeah, sure, Caroline. Yeah, yeah. I mean, what do you feel from those last stanzas? All I'm looking is for a feeling here. Yes, Wendy.
It seemed more hopeful, I guess.
Yeah.
First end.
Yeah, that's a good word. Hopeful, in a real sense. Okay, hopeful because of what? She is, as Carolee Ann's saying, she is experiencing what? Whatever you want it—the grace, beauty, joy, miracle. That this is here, okay, which is considerable. So, and yet she's there too. I was hungry and cold. Okay, so the poet, remember I have that up there. The poet is in there. Okay, already a sunlit smoke was rising from the chimneys and mist from the water. I heard a rooster crowing, and then I heard the whistle of the train from. Okay. No adjectives, all nouns. Why? Why all nouns? I've got a room full of writers. You should be able to tell me that one. Why all nouns, do you think? Why no adjectives there?
Because all feelings are attached to nouns.
That's right. The noun holds an entity, okay, right? Every noun is, in its fashion, a miracle of its sort in that it's achieved some form of, you know, one form or another, which is, right? A noun is. And so merely to evoke those nouns is to, you know, give voice to this vision of the world, which is, that she returns to, that is not a dream, it's there. Okay, what else strikes you about this poem? I'm just opening it up. What else? Yeah, Marianne.
You know, it felt like the Christmas story with the nodding in that it was open.
Mm-hmm.
And then the Christ child running.
Mm-hmm.
And but at the end you have the rooster crowing, which is the passion,
mm-hmm.
where the betrayal happens.
Mm-hmm.
So but it doesn't make sense to read those into it for me because it's like a much more
hopeful. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But yeah. Yeah, you're always in obviously in the Christian tradition, you're there's a lot of barnacles, so to speak, that have accreted to it, and you're it's probably not the best word. But there are a lot of connotations, let's say, okay, that's a better word, that have accreted to the tradition, and some of those echoes are inevitable. Anything about the words I have up here that strike you, or just any thoughts you have about what she's doing here in terms of vision? Yep, Carolyn.
It seems like she makes a place for the vision to happen.
Mm-hmm.
And it's bookended by two visions.
Mm-hmm. The second one is fairer than the first one.
That's right.
So that's why there aren't any adjectives at the end, so that it can be fairer and clearer.
Right. Yeah.
So that it can be changed. But as far as the poemhood or the poet stepping in, it's also she's surrendering to have the vision. In other words, she's making a place in the poem to be surrendered.
Yeah.
Yeah. So like, that's really hard to do.
That is hard to do. Absolutely. That's sort of Carol Ann's point about how it's bookended. I mean, where does the poem begin, okay? It begins in the world of daily human purpose, okay? What is one of the greatest crushers of spirit in this world? Daily human purpose, okay? Gotta do this, gotta do that, don't have time for this, sorry. And, you know, that all gets pushed out the door there. So she begins very lightly. She's got a light touch, but it's there. It's there. You know, she's got a purpose, okay? But then she goes elsewhere, as it were, to the world of the vision. And again, Carol Ann's point, part of the task the poet has faced, particularly in the 20th century, the desacralizing century, is how does the poet situate him or herself so that the poet can present a vision, okay? It wasn't like William Blake was just shooting it right out there, so to speak, because he still lived in a society in which, you know, the bass note, so to speak, was still there. We don't. So what Carol had brought up about how you situate yourself, very important. Okay, any more thoughts about this one? Yeah, Elizabeth?
But the knocking on the door.
Yeah. Yeah, that's good. That's huge, obviously, that knock, knock, knocking on heaven's door. Okay. Any more?
I was struck by the after she realizes she's got to be here on earth, how earthly these last few stanzas are. And then Venus says, gave off the scent of earth in the early morning. She was hungry. Mortal.
Yeah.
The smoke from the chimney.
Yeah.
The whistle of the train.
Yeah. Yeah. All these just very human, very mortal. But, you know, again, this is so beautifully low key how she renders this whole, you know, she's one of those poets. I think her work will become more and more and more known. She's a keeper. Okay. Let's turn now to, let's move past her next poem, and let's look at De Profundis by Vassar Miller. Vassar Miller I could talk a long time about her. She lived in Texas. I have a friend who knew her. He claimed that Vassar used to go to two different churches on Sunday morning. I really like that. She had a hard life. She had multiple sclerosis. Her family sort of, cast her out. But she was, a person of indomitable spirit. And let's look at this one, De Profundis. And you know that's from Psalm 130. Out of the depths, I cry to you, Lord. So that phrase is out of the depths. O Lord, defend me when I go through the dark in daylight. Be with me when I smile peaceably, though tigers tear at my guts. Stay with me, who talk to my friends as an earless monster winks at me. Comfort me, starved and black-tongued, though I eat at dainty tables. Stand by when snowfalls of words melt in deserts of my deafness. Sustain me through morning after morning. I take life from you like death accept me, though I give myself like a cast-off garment to a tramp, or like an idiot's bouquet of onions and roses. Okay, what do we have here? Again, every one of these, I want you to consider what I have up here in terms of approach and function. What do you see here in terms of approach and function? What is she doing here? What kind of poem do we have here? We have a very particular kind of poem that.
A prayer.
Pardon?
A prayer.
Prayer. Yeah, it is definitely a prayer. Okay. It is what I would call a supplication, okay? Where it's this asking, okay? Okay, so beyond that, let's go to vocabulary in this one, okay? What can you tell me about vocabulary in here? I mean, again, these are poems, okay? No one has founded the First Church of Wassermiller yet, okay? These are poems by a poet. So what do you see here? What do you experience here? What is she making available to you as a poet here? Why read poetry? Okay? What is she making available to you? Yeah, Wendy?
There's two very contrasting sort of images. Mm-hmm. She's very stark images.
Yeah. They clash, yeah. They clash. Very good. Yeah.
Sort of like she's showing us the outer beauty, and but revealing her inner suffering at the same time.
Yeah, her inner suffering. Okay. Very good, both of you. Very, very good. So, what kind of prayer do we have here? Would you say what kind of supplication do we have here? What? Another way of saying this is, why do this? Why do this? What does this offer to us as human beings, both to read it and to write it? Got a room full of writers. You could write this. You could do this. You could write a supplication. What's opened up here by taking this course? Okay, I mean this is a big one. This is where a lot trembles, so to speak, on the top of this particular dewdrop. What do you say about that? What does this open up to us as human beings, as creatures that to be able to do this? Look at the title, right? Look at the title. What is the title, right? Out of the depths. What is that? Despair, absolutely. You know, this, to me, this is one answer to despair. One answer to despair, okay? Out of the depths, okay? That we aren't silent, that we can articulate our distress, the collisions, the crises, the torment inside us. We can give voice to that, and that's really important that we can do that, that we could for ourselves and for others. Okay, more about this. That just strikes you more about this in terms of any of the terms up there, or just anything that strikes you in terms of what she's doing here. I mean, Wendy put her finger on the kind of two axes here in terms of her vocabulary here, which is fairly common in spiritual writing, really, that which is exalted, that which is less than exalted. Any thoughts?
This, yeah, Laura. Be with me, stay with me, stand by me,
yeah.
Accept me.
Mm-hmm.
And she's asking God to do these things, to be with her and accept her, to love her,
mm-hmm.
even though,
you know, she's admitting, you know, I smile peaceably and a tiger tearing my guts, and I talk with my friends, but I'm an earless monster. And so, you know, love me anyway. Mm-hmm. I admit that I'm not what maybe I seem to be, or is it the peace on the outside, it's not on the inside. So it's not just help me, it's love me and accept me.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I agree. Yes, Marianne.
I like the senses, the sight and the hearing and the smell.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very human.
Love, yeah.
Despite my humanity.
Yeah.
I'm not.
Right. Yeah, she's very much very much in touch with the physical world, the sensory world. Do you have something, Laura?
Yeah, one thing that I'm seeing in it that's really interesting is it almost exactly mirrors line for line the 23rd Psalm,
mm-hmm.
which would be pretty well known in that religion. And it's just interesting to me, the words she's choosing, it's almost like she's taking this biblical, archaic psalm and humanizing it.
Mm-hmm.
Like she's owning her... her death and her life in it,
mm-hmm.
in a way that's not about an animal or something archaic. It's something that's palpable to her.
Mm-hmm. What would you point to in terms of the language in here? I mean, what struck you about that?
It's just not as like lyrically peaceful,
mm-hmm.
as that psalm would be.
Mm-hmm.
But it's so similar in
right.
content. I mean, mm-hmm. there's some of the same words, but the words that she's put around them
mm-hmm.
make the connotation something even different.
Yeah. Yeah, good, real good. Any more? Any more about, yeah, sure, Peter.
It certainly wasn't the author's intent, but it's reminding me of the character Gabriel from the play Fences by August Wilson.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if anyone's seen that. He goes around and he goes, the character Rose, he brings her roses.
Uh-huh.
And he's been injured in the war, so he's not in full senses.
Uh-huh, mm-hmm, interesting. Interesting echo. Yeah, Elizabeth?
It's pretty dramatic the way she describes her situation, or our situation. Like
mm-hmm.
morning after morning, I take life from you like death.
Mm-hmm.
Like she is death.
Mm-hmm.
We are death.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So death and life. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, that's right. She's, how to say, honest. She's not... not playing around. I mean, you know, there's something at stake here. Okay, I talked last night a bit in the Q&A about consequentiality. Okay, and there's this sense of consequence that she needs this sustenance, right? And that all these pleas for sustenance, you know. And indeed, for each of us to go it alone, so to speak, is pretty hard. Also, I think, and I want you to think about this in the course of looking at these poems, she is in what position, okay? In many ways, she is in a position of dependency, right? She's asking, okay? And again, that goes so much against the temper of recent times, right, where so much it's about control, right? We all live in this world of switches and knobs and, you know, all day long we're manipulating things, you know? We're not asking, we're controlling. That's very different. So she's in a different position. I would argue that's a crucial human position, because if we aren't in that position, then aspects of life to begin with, such as humility and gratitude, thanksgiving, they just elude us. We don't know what they are, really. We don't know what they are necessarily. Okay, any more about this poem? Yep, sure.
I'm just really trying to grasp what she meant with stay with me who talk to my friends. So here she is talking to her friends as an earless monster winks at me.
Yeah.
What
okay.
is that earless monster winking at her? What does that mean?
Okay, gang, what do you think that earless monster? Yes, Carly.
That kind of brings me to something I was thinking, which is not all the stuff that's bad about her is actually in her. You know, not everything in the poem that she's complaining about is something that she thinks she sucks about. Some of it is temptation or things around her that are that are drawing her off of what she considers a path, or, you know, so like the earless monster could be in or out of her, but it's something that, you know, it's something that causes her to be deaf. Because deafness comes up after that, right? Deserts of mind deafness. So, I mean, she's there talking, but she's also being winked at by something that could take her away from.
And what is a wink, like, what is the winking stuff like, Jill? Like, making fun of, or like.
Yeah, I'd say, yeah, I'd say it's, yeah, yeah, yeah.
I know who you really are.
Yeah.
Pardon?
I know who you really are.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, that kind of wink, yeah.
Well, and it's the language of guts and tigers and, you know, all the language that isn't biblical in the poem, it goes with that language.
Yeah, wink.
But it could it be that they aren't hearing? Mm-hmm. Is that what the earless monster?
Yeah, yeah.
Talking but not listening.
The friend could be the earless monster, so the bad thing she's doing is
thinking that friend
is a monster.
Right. As I like it. Yes, raw.
I'm thinking that the line break there kind of allows the reader to kind of make more than one assumption about her literally being maybe an earless monster, someone who's not really paying attention, and the earless monster being someone who is maybe the temptation or something who knows exactly what she is or who she really is underneath, or what she's really doing. So it's kind of, I almost see it as an opportunity to see it more than one way.
Right, as I like to say, some of you have heard me say it, poetry is both and mine, not either or mind. So you're right, it's all there. Okay, more, any more? Yeah, Aline.
Like she's praying. There's like something bigger than belief, the intellectual.
Mm-hmm.
Because everything that she's describing would suggest there isn't a reason to.
Mm-hmm.
So that I just thought of that.
Mm-hmm.
That reminds me, I was thinking as bad as the images are, she's having a tremendous amount of fun. So, with the language.
Yeah. Yeah.
In the juxtaposition being fun to me.
Yeah.
Tigers tear at my gut.
Yeah.
Like, so she's singing on that level.
Yeah.
She's
now that's
joyful on that level.
Yeah. Yeah, she, that's a wonderful thing about her poetry, is it just always has this temper in terms of language, and you just can feel in her kind of always just scrabbling and kicking and jumping up and down on the playground in certain ways. As a human being. I love that about her. Okay, any more about this one? Okay, in our movement here now, we are moving to a psalm by Thomas Merton. A psalm by Thomas Merton. When psalms surprise me with their music, and antiphons turn to rum, the spirit sings, the bottom drops out of my soul, and from the center of my cellar, love, louder than thunder, opens a heaven of naked air. New eyes awaken. I send love's name into the world with wings, and songs grow up around me like a jungle. Choirs of all creatures sing the tunes your spirit played in Eden. Zebras and antelopes and birds of paradise shine on the face of the abyss, and I am drunk with the great wilderness of the sixth day of Genesis. But sound is never half so fair as when that music turns to air and the universe dies of excellence. Sun, moon, and stars fall from their heavenly towers. Joys walk no longer down the blue world's shore, though fires loiter, lights still fly on the air of the gulf. All fear, another wind, another thunder. Then one more voice snuffs all their flares in one gust. And I go forth with no more wine and no more stars and no more buds and no more Eden and no more animals and no more sea, while God sings by himself in acres of night and walls fall down, that guarded paradise. Wow. Okay, again, let's start at the place of what kind of poem do we have? Well, he tells us what kind of poem we have, doesn't he? He's writing a psalm. Okay, he's writing a psalm. So you've encountered psalms. So back when I was a boy, we recited them every morning in public school. So what can you say about this as a psalm? What strikes you here? What is he doing? What kind of journey or path is being enacted here in this psalm? Often in a psalm, there's a plea, an invocation, a supplication, but many times there is some journey that is occurring within the psalm. What is happening in here? What do you see occurring in here? What it's, you know, again, you're going to start to see there how these poems are put together, which is part of their poemhood, you know, in terms of what they specifically offer to us as poems rather than, you know, what's in the Bible or what's in other spiritual traditions, sutras or whatever. So what do you think here? You have any thoughts about this in terms of, yeah, Wendy?
It seems like the music or the poem builds and builds and builds and until there's like a sort of like climax and everything evaporates. There's like a, and the pause is where there's, like there's no sound, and that's what,
yeah, no, this is hard stuff to articulate, yeah. Did you all hear?
No.
Yeah, okay. Builds, is that?
Yeah.
What, Laura?
And the universe dies of excellence. Everything vanishes. Is that where you're thinking?
The end is sort of the pause of the whole piece that it climaxes to, right?
Uh-huh.
And everything sort of is taken away.
Right.
Does that make any sense?
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. This is hard stuff to put into words. Thank you. Yeah.
I don't know if I'm just grasping at like outside knowledge or if it like seems like it's almost the Jericho story, you know, the walls of Jericho, the sound, and then the walls
come tumbling down. Mm-hmm. That's a connotation. That's valid. Let's talk vision. What is the vision of, say, the first part of the poem that Wendy's talking about, where it's building, it's building, it's building? What kind of vision do we have here? New eyes awaken. I said love's name. Zebras, antelopes. Music turns to air. Okay. What? Where are we in that first part? Choirs of all creatures sing the tunes. Where are we there? Can you say where we are there in terms of the first part of the poem? Any takers on that in terms of what he's evoking there? Pardon?
You know, the choirs of heavenly angels and part of that.
It's a kind of choir. For me, what he's... What? Well, yeah, in a sense, yeah. That which becomes the creation, basically, and is the creation, okay? Which is, you know, miraculous and joyful and remarkable and all the wonderful words you want to use about it, okay? And that, you know, we should strive each day to be alive to. But there's a but. The universe dies of excellence. There's this fall that Carol Ann commented. We have a though. All fear another wind, another thunder. Then one more voice snuffs all their flares in one gust. And then the poet is in here too. And I go forth with no more wine and no more stars and no more buds and no more Eden and no more animals and no more sea. Wonderful passage. And then that colon, while God sings by himself in acres of night and walls fall down, that guarded paradise. Okay. All I'm looking for here is, what does that make you feel? Okay, we don't have to go into what this quote means, okay? Because I always think when I'm at this place, I worked a lot in schools, and I would encounter teachers who would say, what did Shakespeare mean to say here? And, you know, he said it. He didn't mean to say it, he said it. So we can let that one go. I'm concerned with what do you experience here? What do you feel here at the end? What's occurring? Yeah, Bethany.
It's kind of like a sobering, like a reality check in a way. Mm-hmm. It's like this grand party of creation, and all of a sudden it's like just this realism of like, now I just have to keep on going.
Uh-huh. Right. I really like that. Reality check. I like that phrase a lot. I don't know if there's a Sunday morning show yet called Reality Check, but there's probably should be. Yeah, Laura.
It looks like the speaker makes contact with God.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Paradise, the gates, the guard of paradise.
Right. Yes. Makes contact, okay? And I think of the word that Elaine just used, bigger, okay? Something bigger is at work here, okay? Something bigger. And we know in the Bible they're always encountering something bigger than their little ways and notions, you know? And that bigger voice sometimes speak to them, and sometimes it's thunder, and sometimes it's what? It's very frightening, chastising, and many other things that they're not particularly keen on hearing, right? So it's, and this is why this poem has astonished me for a long time, that he's able to go to this place. I mean, for me, in terms of just, I don't know how other to put it, spiritual depth, this poem is really, I find it to be fairly extraordinary. Any more about the end that you, yeah, Carolyn?
Yes, so it's so sad because of the way the comma works.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's like, so it's all gone.
Mm-hmm.
By the time you read that Garden Paradise, there's this sort of elegiac quality.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, at least nostalgia.
Yeah. Well, again, I think it's that both and mine. We have it and we don't have it.
Right.
You know?
Beckett, it's I'll go on, I can't go on.
Right.
On.
Yeah. Which is, you know, that feels like wisdom to me. Yep.
Like a retelling of he does say Genesis, but the Genesis story and the fall of man and the separation from God, but this happens regularly. It's like this whole fall of man, separation from God is something that is occurring in your life on a daily basis or on a, you know, however long.
I'd agree. I'd agree. And again, thinking of, you know, why go write poems? What you just raised, that point, it's a pretty big one. Pretty big one. Yeah. Any more about this? Any more about Merton's poem? Okay. Moving on. It's good I'm doing this. I'm probably not going to even get through eight of them. So this is Denise Levertov, okay? I brought with me the collected poems of Denise Levertov. yeah. What?
Didn't she not finish high school?
Something like, yeah. She also won a poetry contest at what, the age of, I don't know, 11, and the judge was T.S. Eliot. That's not the usual judge for a poetry contest in a newspaper, right? Oh, kid, you won a poetry contest. He wrote her a letter and said, essentially, you're the real thing. You're going to be a poet. So, guy knew something. Let's look at this one. To Live in the Mercy of God by Denise Levertov. To lie back under the tallest, oldest trees. How far the stems rise, rise before ribs of judgment. Century, oh, or ah, uninterrupted voice, many stranded, to breathe, spray, the smoke of it, arcs of steel white foam, glissades of fugitive jade, barely perceptible, such passion, rage, or joy, thus. Not mild, not temperate, God's love for the world. Vast flood of mercy flung on resistance. Starting to notice they all keep talking about the same thing. Which is kind of inevitable, right? There's human beings, there's the natural world. There's that spirit world and what happens among the three. Okay, it's a pretty extraordinary poem, To Live in the Mercy of God. So what, you know, what do we have here as an approach? I'm open to takers in terms of how you would, you know, kind of classify this in terms of what she's doing here. To me, this is a poem of personal attentiveness. That quality without which, really, why are we here and what are we doing? If we don't manifest that quality in our lives. Again, though, there's a degree of what? There's a degree of conflict in here. And again, a kind of, I mean, that infinitive, to live in the mercy of God, right, that is actually to do that, that is also possibly a supplication, too. I wish to live in the mercy of God. And, of course, vocabulary, right? That's a pretty big word, isn't it? The word mercy. Okay, it's not a word we hear too much nowadays. anything from the words up here, anything that's striking you in terms, I mean, this is so fascinating because Levertov is a poet. You know, she's born in England. She comes to the States. She meets William Carlos Williams. She has this whole transfiguration, as it were. As a poet, she becomes very involved in the world of emerging post-World War II free verse poetry in the United States. She's a huge force in that. She writes about it. And Levertov's poetry has been likened by many, because she wrote about this herself, to dance, okay? Don't you feel, as you hear and read this, a sense of movement, that she's moving through space and time here? So there's that active sense of step by step, okay? She doesn't know where she's going. She's alive in the moment, okay? Which in the spiritual world is what? That sort of radical freedom and radical dependency at the same time that's going on in her work. And so it's really manifested for you there on the page, right? When you look at it, right? Why doesn't she just stay on the left margin like a good girl, you know? Because that's she's not a good girl. She wants to use the page as part of this experiencing, this moment by moment, I don't know how to put it in words exactly, movement, dance, I don't know, you know how to say it. Yeah, and that's great, yeah.
Yeah, and she's not willing necessarily to use the sentence even. You know, she does
yeah.
Fine. She tells us the complete sentence, too adequate has no give.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, that's a great word, Carly. Improvisational, okay? Which is what? Making it up, okay? So there are all these traditions, and there's this big word, God, but each of us is in each of our own ways making it up, okay, in terms of our sense of being here, okay? So she is enacting that, okay? And also moment by moment going through what? Her perceptions, right? Which what? They just, do they all fall on one side? No, of course not. They don't, okay? What about those perceptions? I need to hear from you more. What about the quality of, just tell me any line in the poem that strikes you here in terms of the, you know, the perceptions that she's offering you. What would you say? Okay, yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's referring to how we are resistant, as she says at the very end, mm-hmm. resistant to this mercy of God. We're resistant to all that God wants to mm-hmm. pour on us, and mm-hmm. we are like clenched fists and rock and won't receive it.
Yeah, very, very good. This hardness, okay? So that's definitely part of the dialogue in here is the hardness. Very good, Peter.
I like the paradox and jamming of to breathe, spray, the smoke of it.
Yeah.
Smoke.
Yeah.
Looking at the waterfall.
Yeah, so there's that physical enactment. Yeah. Marianne?
I thought the awe and that comfort.
Yeah.
You think, oh, God is all comfort, but, you know, there's
yeah.
moments of discomfort to get to that comfort and keep your friends that
loving. Yeah, I love that. That she can say a lot in a few words, can't she? I mean, at the basis of poetry is what? Awe. That's one reason to be writing poems, is to just manifest your awe. But the comfort, I think of in Paris during the events of May in 1968, one of the students' slogans was, this is so classic French, is your comfort will kill you. Yeah.
Why would you say that she achieves with this putting here and there on the page?
Yeah.
She's putting the sentences over there.
Yeah.
Over
yeah.
Space.
Yeah.
For me, I get a little confused.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't get the flow of.
Yeah.
So I'm going to type it up and put it all in one place.
Right.
That's just like, I mean, part of it is William's influence, right?
Right. Yeah, this is what this has been likened to, Elizabeth, is what is an open field, okay? And if the poem is an open field, then you want to experience the openness of the field. You don't just want to go through it like that. You want to go here and go there, okay? So that's it's an amplitude, an openness that she's evoking there, which could have a lot of connotations for the spiritual life, okay? So,
it's like the closest good point. You can come to floating off the page. I mean, you can't do that.
Right, that's right. No, you can't exactly float off the page. Yep. Very good. Space, right. Doesn't happen quickly. It's not in some lockstep march kind of thing, which the margin can make you feel when you go down that left margin. Okay, any more? Yeah, Wendy.
I was just going to say it's also the same as the words that she's using, like to float off the page. Mm-hmm.
Mm.
You know?
I do know.
So it correlates with what she's talking about, just floating up to his body.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, we always talk about form and content and how they're supposed to go together. Here it is, okay? The words are enacting, so to speak, okay?
Marianne mentioned the God of all comfort. And mm-hmm. The phrase that I was thinking of when I was reading this was the peace that passes all understanding. Mm-hmm. It felt to me like she was taking those very abstract phrases and making them concrete with all this floating on salt water and you know, the ribs of shelter open and the flying foxes and you know, she was trying to express those things that
that's very good, Laura, because I mean, again, asking the why do this question. I think what you're saying is that doing the writing and also to read it offers each of us the chance to actualize, okay? To actualize these, as you say, abstractions, okay? Mercy is an abstraction, okay? Technically. But after you read this poem, I dare say you might not feel it's quite so abstract, okay? In terms of embodiment, okay? Or, you know, that's the word I always use for poetry. I always say poetry is not about description. It's about embodiment. You take on a body, okay? And in that sense, to use a very connotative word, it's incarnational, okay? It takes on a body. Good. Bill.
I just wanted to say one quick thing. What impresses me most about this poem is her attempt to articulate transcendence.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's not so easy to do. You know, and she's kind of done it.
She's kind of done it.
Trees and then with a waterfall.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It's pretty amazing.
It is pretty amazing to articulate, transcendence. Again, big abstract word. You know, but to...
Of course, the point of spirituality.
Right. Yeah, yeah. I mean, that, and in that sense, I guess, since I'm not going to get through them all, I want to go to Levertov's second poem here. I knew Levertov's husband pretty well in rural Maine, a man named Mitchell Goodman. So I have, you know, certain... whatever, feelings and notions about them. I have a good friend who studied with her. Okay, so this is For Instance by Denise Levertov. You got this one? For Instance? Okay. For instance, often, it's nowhere special, maybe a train rattling not fast or slow from Melbourne to Sydney, and the lights fading, we've passed that wide river remembered from a tale about boyhood and fatal love written in vodka prose, clear and burning, the lights fading, and then beside the tracks, this particular straggle of eucalyptus, an inconsequential bit of a wood, a coppice looks your way, not at you, through the train, over it, gazes with branches and rags of bark to something beyond your passing. It's not this shred of seeing, more beautiful than a million others, less so than many. You have no past here, no memories, and you'll never set foot among these shadowy, tentative presences. Perhaps when you've left this continent, you'll never return, but it stays with you years later, whenever its blurry image flicks on in your head. It wrenches from you the old cry, O Earth, beloved Earth. Like many another faint constellation of landscape does, or fragment of lichened stone, or some old shed where you took refuge once from pelting rain in Essex, leaning on wheel or shafts of a dusty cart, and came out when you heard a blackbird return to song, though the rain was not quite over. And as you thought there'd be, there was, in the dark quarter where frowning clouds were still clustered, a hesitant trace of rainbow. And across from that, the expected gleam of East Anglian afternoon light and leaves dripping and shining, puddles and the roadside weeds washed of their dust. Earth, that inward cry again, Erde, du Liebe, which is German, earth, you love. Oh, poem that always moves me basically to tears. Incredible. Okay, about this one. In terms of, you know, the kind of poem this is, well, let me throw it out to you. What do you think? What kind of poem do we have here in terms of, you know, kind of poem? Yeah, I think it's a praise poem. I think it's an evocation. Again, it's this power that we're given through language of actualization and trying to, again, embody, take on. But it also has an element to me of what I call God talk, trying to talk to the creation, or maybe I should say creation talk. To have, so to speak, I don't know how to say, a dialogue, a conversation with it that's very important to us as human beings, so that it be meaningful, you know, for us in terms of this incredible gift that each of us inherits when he or she comes into this world. Let me just open this up to you in terms of what I have up here: style, approach, function, vocabulary, transfiguration, memory, mystery, sacred, poet, poemhood. Anything up here strike you in terms of what she is doing here in this poem? What, to pick one, what about memory? Well, how does memory figure in this, would you say? Memory? Any thought? I mean, it's right in there, right? What is memory?
Some shed where you took refuge once from a pelting rain.
Yeah. 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 Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, and so she's allowing the God thing to come into whatever the mind chooses to say.
Yeah.
Whatever memory comes at that moment, yeah, render it sacred.
Yeah, that's good. I mean, there is, In English, we don't have that word that the Germans have, which is Geist, you know? And that is mind, spirit. Is that how you see that word, Wendy? Mind, spirit?
Yeah, Geist.
Geist. Is that fair? Yeah, both sides? And so it's what you're saying, Kelly, it's that it's at that place, okay? Because we think of memory as a mind place. Oh, I remember when Uncle Henry, you know. But it's a spirit place too, okay? It's very much a spirit place. I don't know how to put it. It's in an inhabited place, you know? All these things that come into us inhabit us. I once had a student who was in you, and she lived way up Point Barrow, Alaska. That's pretty far north. And she said, I used to talk to her about the spirit world, and what is the crux of it to you? What are the dilemmas we face as human creatures living in the spirit world? And she said, well, a big one is, she was kind of humoring me, but not humoring me. She said, a big one, Baron, is every time we eat, we take in spirit. Okay. So all that, those supplications to the creatures that, you know, so-called primitive tribes do, obviously about that. But this all goes to the place in the poem of what? At the end, earth, that inward cry again. Okay? So what's she doing there when she writes? How does she come to that place as her ending of this poem? This poem kind of rambles around, you know, there's this, there's that. She's in Australia, you know, then she's back in her childhood home. And then she ends with this. What?
Impersonating a confessional poem of a certain type, for instance, you know, and then she's kind of like blowing it up.
Blowing it up. Okay, yeah, there's something very powerful and emotional that she's going toward here. We haven't talked probably enough about just sheer feeling in these poems and how emotion is driving these poems as an engine. I want to stay with this, okay, in terms of the ending. Again, one way is how do you feel with this ending? What does it do to you? What happens at this ending? I mean, this is a different kind of ending, really. This is not the way every poem ends by any stretch of the imagination. So what does it make you feel here? What's occurring? Is it Bill?
Feels to me like she's trying to get at what Joyce meant by epiphany.
Uh-huh.
That moment where the finite meets the infinite.
Yeah.
And she gives us two instances from her life.
Right.
Where she had those, you know, very mysterious, sacred moments
right.
in the secular world.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what struck me as.
Mm-hmm. Yet another word I left off the blackboard, epiphany, okay? And as, you know, Bill's talking about James Joyce's stories in the Dubliners and perhaps most famously The Dead, which is about death and life. But I agree. I think she's at this crux of, I don't know how to say, where she's trying to say the unsayable, and it is a prayer, a supplication at the end. She's at that place. I mean, how the poem ends, you know, with what? It ends with what? How does the poem end? With ellipses. What is that? What is she doing there? What?
That's a no-no.
That's a no-no. Oh, well. School is out, I guess, Laura, for her. So, okay, let's say it's a yes, okay? So what is going on there? What does that make happen? Mm-hmm. Yeah. What did you say? Final sigh?
Yeah.
That's a beautiful phrase. final sigh, okay, those ellipses, what do they push out into, okay? Where do they push out into? What's the difference between if she ended it with a period or an exclamation mark rather than the ellipses? What's the difference? In terms of the ending of this, what can you articulate anything? Okay, you advance to the next round, Marianne.
She ends with this earth cry, mm-hmm. but it's the earth is only a manifestation of the creator. Mm-hmm. So the praise is also going to be on the earth, which is
mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right,
right. Well, that's part of what is probably beyond the ellipses, so to speak, you know. But Levertov was a very, earth-grounded poet. So whatever arises, so to speak, you can see in these poems, comes from vision in and of and with the earth. So for her to get to that other place, you know, up as it were, first here. Any more about this one? Any more that's striking you about, for instance, I will stop asking questions. It's 5:00, but I have one more I want to ask you, which is, what's with the title? I saw you shake your head there, Tim, like, yeah, what's with poets? What's with their titles, right? Novelists, they just do one and they've got the job done, right? Poets.
She's having a hard time explaining what this moment, this epiphany is, and in order to explain it, mm-hmm. she gives this description of it. So for instance, and mm-hmm. she can't explain the word that mm-hmm. she's trying to, so she must explain it in a sentence, so it's a for instance.
Yeah, yeah.
Explain what her.
And this is just a small
well
part
said.
Of everything that it could be.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah.
There's also the tentative nature of it. Right. And there's a heartbreaking nostalgia about this poem. Mm. If here she is alive on the earth, experiencing these sort of magical moments of mm-hmm. the ordinary mm-hmm. with, that will go on forever. Mm-hmm. You know, the whole ellipsis idea. Mm-hmm. For instance, mm-hmm. I'll just give you a couple of them.
Right, that's beautifully said, Bill. Beautifully
that
said.
That goes perfectly with the ellipses. You know, mm-hmm. this is an ongoing
it'll
forever.
It'll happen again.
And that's good. That makes it not, it's tender at the end because you have to let each one go.
Right.
But you can be pretty sure there's another one coming.
Yeah, yeah, mm-hmm. yeah.
Except for the waterfall and the trees from the earlier poem.
Yeah.
And that's all about... The mercy of God is all about this same transcendence.
Right.
It's all together
yeah.
for her.
Yeah, it is. That's a good note to end on, I think. That's a good note to end on. So thank you very much.